Sam, Michel, Aurel. And I think that if you do the measurement analysis, you can process and calculate by the nodes easily. Okay? So in fact, I don't need to teach the team set. But here, some introductions. He's doing measurement analysis of image analysis and image processing. And he got some awards recently. So 2010, he became a clay scholar in residence. And also in 2010, he got the European Research Council Laureate. He got the 2013 Grand Prix India. India is the French Academy of Science. And so he will give a talk about the today mathematical perspective of imaging. Okay.
Thank you very much for this invitation, and thank you also for the fantastic organization of this conference and the dedication of all the young ones that we see at all everywhere helping us. So precisely, I would like also to thank my own collaborators that come from three continents, and they have helped me not only prepare this talk, but also thank you. Do you hear me? So let me thank my collaborators, Miguel Colom, Marc Lebrun, Nicola Pirazzo, Martin Rice, Lydie Wong, and they did the algorithms that they will present. And at the beginning, at least, I will read, because I know that my English might be a problem for you, as it is for me. So you will make a one-to-one correspondence between my words and what you read, so that maybe it will be easier. So image denoising is a complex mathematical operation performed routinely in billions of cameras. Every digital image and every video is systematically processed numerically. In this talk, I will put in evidence new, very simple denoising formula that have been invented in the past 10 years and account for the steady improvement of image quality. By the way, so science and technology, we have this session, okay? So they require verification. So all algorithms that I will show can be tested on any image in the denoising section of the electronic journal, Image Processing Online, IPOL, and here's the address of the website. Just a very short introduction about what is a camera. A camera oscura, this is here, this goes back at least to the 16th century, and probably to the antiquity, to Plato's works, to Plato's writings, and some people mention it. And a modern camera are in fact quite similar. The photons emitted by the objects go through a pinhole, that in the case of a camera is an abstract pinhole because it's a focus, but the role is the same, and hit a surface. Here the surface is just for visualization, and in a camera we have a photosensitive surface, and this photosensitive surface is a sensor matrix. So the image is directly sampled on a rectangular grid. A digital image, therefore, is nothing but a matrix of observed numbers. And here comes the problem. Each pixel, pixel means picture element, x, receives a number of photons u of x. This number is a random variable due to the quantum effects of light emission and other random perturbation. Its expectation is the ideal image, e u of x, and the difference, u of x minus the expectation, u of x, so the difference between observed and ideal, is the noise. Our goal is to remove the noise, namely to guess the expectation, knowing only the observed, u of x. This is how it looks, a noisy image, the ideal image, and the difference. How can you get an ideal image? Actually, you can. It's a question of time. You can acquire, if on a steady, on a still scene, you can acquire for a very long time the image, and then the fluctuations by the law of large numbers, when we console, at the end you get a perfect image. I will show some perfect image during the talk. Just to mention, because sometimes it can create confusion, in fact we process color images, but there is no major difference with images which have only photon count. In the case of color image, we have three photon counts, red, green, and blue, and each component is itself a Poisson random variable. Therefore, denoising again means estimating the three true values, expectations of these components at each pixel. So, what is the problem again, and how can we solve it? Knowing that it is at first sight it's obvious. Each image pixel is a random vector, as we just saw. And we dispose of a single sample of each pixel. We have only one observation for each pixel. Yet, we want to estimate the expectation of this random vector from this single sample. This problem is completely imposed. Yet, one can solve it somehow. Here is an example that was provided to us by DXO Labs, an image processing company. And so the picture you see here has been obtained directly from the raw image. So it's a raw incoming image. And this is how it would look like if no image denoising would be applied. And here is the result after denoising. I can alternate if you wish. Before, and you see that the quality improves a lot, in particular noise somehow disappears. And so there must be some reason for that. And the reason for that I will try to develop in four formulas. The four formulas I will talk about, actually the first thing is not exactly first, the first two will be about the past. I mean what has been done first to denoise images, and this is, for instance, what can be done by DCG denoising. I will also go back to the past by talking about neighborhood filters. And finally, I will go on to new ways of looking at things, which are non-local means and the Bayesian denoising. So first a few words about transform threshold, because this has been a very popular method. And it's still quite used, I will show where and how. So transform thresholding is a recurrent algorithm as old as image processing. It can be based on the Fourier transform, on wavelets, on the discrete cosine transform. And the idea of this method is that the image itself is by nature sparse on such frequency-based basis. And sparsity in the sense that we saw mentioned in this congress, the Condes-Romberg-Tao notion of sparsity means in fact that a few coefficients of the images are large and the other are very small or zero. And therefore, noise frequency coefficients which are instead completely flat, because noise is characterized by the fact that all frequency coefficients have the same variance. So noise frequency coefficients, we can be simply cut off, can be cancelled, and typically with a threshold that will be lower than three times their standard deviation. And in that way, one can remove noise coefficients without altering much the image. So, for instance, DCT. DCT is one of the possible frequency transform. By the way, generally all frequency transform methods are local, be it if you use Fourier, you will use Fourier local Fourier. If you use a wavelet, it's naturally local. So the DCT denoising is based on this basis, the cosine transform, whose formula is just here. N is frequency in X, M is frequency in L, and these are the vectors of this basis. And so the algorithm, it's very simple, it's completely described here. Still, it's the most complicated formula I will show in this talk. First, calculate the transform. So first, extract from the image patches. Patches are patches, I will denote them by peaks. Patches are simply small blobs in the image, typically 8x8. And so we have as many patches as pixels in the image, so they overlap, of course. So each one of them can be transformed by DCT. Then, as I mentioned, the small DCT coefficients, which generally correspond to the high frequencies, but not necessarily can be cancelled if their value is below some threshold value linked to the noise. And then, by inverse DCT, one can reconstruct a patch that is half as much as noise. Once this has been done, each patch has been denoised, and each pixel X is contained in 64 patches, because each patch is 8x8, it has 64 pixels. So conversely, each pixel is in 64 patches, and therefore, averaging with all the estimates gives you an excellent denoising. I will show you some examples immediately. So this is, for instance, a moderate noise, 15, and this is what you get by denoising with this method. As you see, do you see something? By the way, yes? Okay, so the method seems to work, and if you compare, in fact, the original here and the denoised, you will see some alterations, but really very few ones. So, big invention, but now, what happens with more noise? So you will say, why should we have more noise while technology is better every day? Well, technology means more pixels. Pixels are smaller. Customers are always asking for more. And so it turns out that digital images, are as noisy as ever. And so this is a typical example of what you can have in a raw image in a camera. And if you apply DCT denoising to that, you will get that. So if I turn it, you see, noisy denoised. Anyway, so the denoised, I'm not sure you can see it. I hope you can see it. It is blurry, and it has typically what we call Gibbs effect or ringing artifacts. I mean oscillations, spurious oscillations that we cannot remove. To see what it means, I alternate now the original and the denoise. As you see, the denoise is not acceptable. So this leads me to look in the past and discuss other approaches to image denoising. And I will talk now about neighborhood filters. So the principle of neighborhood filters is absolutely elementary. It's the variance decreasing principle by your mean. So assume for a moment that I said at the beginning that in an image we have only one sample of each pixel. So the situation, because of that, it is a spread. But assume for a moment that the image contains other pixels that had the very same color as the pixel that we want to denoise. So we assume in our terms that we have twin pixels in the image, U of X1, U of X2, U of XL. So they are all noisy samples of the same underlying color, which means that their mean will be a much better estimate of each one of them. And the variance formula here expresses this in that way. The variance of an average is the variance of each one of the values divided by n. That means, for instance, that if we find, just by some miracle, 16 samples for U of X in the image, we can divide the noise by 4, which is huge, a huge division. And if you find, say, 81, you can divide by 9, and so on. Why by 4 and not by 16? Because I'm dividing the variance by 16, but what matters is the standard deviation. The standard deviation will be divided by the square root of n. This is why I mentioned 4 here. Now, of course, you can figure out very elementary methods to put in common pixels. One of them is simply to convolve the image with a Gaussian. Why a Gaussian? Because a Gaussian is a nice local neighborhood. The probability that a pixel looks like the central pixel, the probability that y looks like x decreases quickly when y goes away from x. So it's quite natural to think that by convolving an image with a Gaussian, you will indeed obtain a first sort of neighborhood filter. And indeed, it is true that by doing that, noise will be decreased. But on the other hand, this is obviously insufficient because convolving an image with a Gaussian means making it blurry. So making it blurry is certainly not a good thing to do, and instead it's going to add a new perturbation. So there is a solution. The solution is not new, and it's called neighborhood filters. The idea is that pixels Y will be turned similar to X if they are close in space, in location, but also in value. Thus, in other terms, we will say that another pixel U of Y contributes to the estimate of U of X if and only if X is close to Y, or Y is close to X, rather, and also, and very important, U of Y is close to U of X. So let's look at the formula. The formula is here. But before commenting on the formula, I would like to mention something that will please my old friend Stanley Osher. This formula has been discovered not less than four times in the Soviet Union in the 80s, in 83 in America, probably those discoveries were independent, more recently in England in 97, and finally in the States again in 98. And so the names were neighborhood filters, sigma filters, Susan, bilateral filter. Guess how the method is called now. As Osher says, it's always better to be the last to have made a discovery. So the method is called bilateral filter. So anyway, just as a credit to the first invention, so I will call it for a while neighborhood filter. And the formula here is a nonlinear formula, but it's quite simple as you see. It involves two kernels. One kernel is the Gaussian kernel that alone would entail that we only do a convolution of the image U to obtain the result. But we have here this nonlinear term, for the Gaussian is three-dimensional because we have, we remember, three channels, three color channels. And this this Gaussian will be equal to 1 if U of Y is exactly equal to U of X, which means that both are exactly the same sample, but have exactly the same value. And in general, so this will give weight in the average only to pixels Y, which value is close to U of X. So in that way, see, this is illustrated here. This is the spatial kernel, and this is the order. This is by what it is multiplied. You see, assuming that the image here is an edge, so it has a sharp, step. If we convert this step edge with the Gaussian, we get a blurry edge. But by doing so, by using this half-cut kernel. And on one side of this image, it will give you exactly the right value on the right, exactly the right value on the left, because the kernel is choosing, so to say, its side, and therefore the denoised image remains sharp. So now, a generalization of that, non-local means. So I hope that, well, we are here in the mathematical congress, so mathematicians should of course, find ways to find very simple formulas, as we have seen in the laudation of Stanley Osher. We look for very simple formulas. This is one very simple formula that was proposed by Boadesco actually and myself, and it's a simplification of the former one. In it here, the simplification consists in removing the space, the partial term, and making this term slightly more sophisticated, but in a very natural way. So the idea is that now we make an assumption. At the end, we'll see the assumption is useless, but it's not necessary. But for the time being, we will make it. The assumption is that any image, for reasons that actually escape, so to say, our theory, I mean, it's a fact of nature, any image is made of an image is self-similar. It's made of groups that turn out to look alike, so locally. So for instance, in this image of a French castle, we have patches in the sky. They are all alike. Patches along the edge of the roof, The roof is periodic, and so these patches again are alike, and so on. So each group, therefore, is likely to be used for this principle of neighborhood filters. So the change in the formula is just to replace the value at a point by the value in a whole neighborhood. So here is a vector that contains all values in each patch, and the Gaussian noise n-dimensional because n is the dimension of the patch, and therefore one defines as a single denoising formula this formula here that tells that the denoised version of a patch will be this weighted average of all patches all over the image, but weighted by their distance to the original patch. In other terms, the integral here is global. This is why the method is called non-local. We see now all three formulas in the same slide. Here the Gaussian convolution, here neighborhood filter, and as you see, the non-local means here as a sort of a simplification of this one, because we only keep this part, and also formally quite close to this one. In fact, it might be said that this formula here suggests to do a convolution not on the image space, here we have omega, but in the patch space. And this is what is going next. But before I do it, I would like just to demonstrate the fact that the progress in these formulas. Here is an original picture scanned from a magazine. Here is a Gaussian convolution. Here is the result of neighborhood filter, and here is the result of non-local means. And probably you can see an expert will see differences, and probably I'm not sure you can see it at a distance. But anyway, you can see the difference between the Gaussian and the original, neighborhood filter and the original, and non-local means and the original. The game is the following. Denoising means removing only noise. So the result will be good if we only see noise. Clearly here, we don't have only noise, we also have signal, so we have lost signal in the noise, okay? And actually, it's simple to figure out why, because convolving an image with a Gaussian making the difference means computing its Laplacian. So what you see is the Laplacian of the image. Nevertheless, we certainly also remove noise, for instance, on the cheek. Here, with the neighborhood filter, as you see, edges are fading, and I showed why. And finally, with the local means, as you cannot recognize any more face. That's good. We almost have here only noise, as far as we can judge visually. Last formula will be a variant of the preceding ones, and in fact it is the same formula, only the domain of integration will be wider. And here we can think about technology. When we started doing image processing, it was difficult to handle a small image. Now, in the past year, we have started handling very big images, but with internet, we now have access to all images. So having access to all images is actually technologically possible because it only needs to have a smart computer and to download all possible images on the internet. And so the space of all images is starting to exist. So for people who like functional space, this is good news. And more locally, the space of all patches in the world we can evaluate millions of billions, I don't know how to say how much is that, millions of billions, I don't know, whatever it is, patches. And actually companies are doing it and are actually doing this sort of work to download all this. So given this fact, an old formula can become effective, as was noticed by Nadler and Levy in 2011. So their reasoning is as follows. The noise model is simple. Given a patch, the probability of the noisy patch is given noisy patch obtained by adding noise to Q, is given by a simple Gaussian. Okay? We know already this Gaussian, so it appears here again. Now, the best estimate we can get of a patch Q given the noisy patch is its expectation. expectation, knowing all other patches, which means integrating of the span on the set of all patches, the probability of Q knowing P times Q dQ. So this integral is huge, of course. It's an integral of, as I said, billions of trillions, but we can envisage it. We can think of it. And we will do more than envisage it. Actually, this formula is not useful because probability of Q, the non-noisy patch knowing the noisy one, is not easy to compute. But Bayes' formula tells us that you can revert the roles of Q and P. And here, this is what is done here. You have here P of P, probability of P knowing Q, instead of probability of Q knowing P. And the price to pay is to divide by the probability of P, but we don't care because P is given. So it's a fixed number here. So it's not important because this formula is anyway an average. So using this and this, we get what? Again, the non-local mis formula, but the integration, instead of being done on only the image, is done on the set of all patches. What is the difference? Before, I used the argument of the image subsimilarity to justify this formula, where here P was replaced by omega, the domain of the image. Maybe I can do it here, showing where we compare all methods. So the comparison is between those two formulas. They are identical up to the point that we have, by interacting, we are using only the patch of one single image, and here we are using all patches. This is old fashioned. This is good, because here, to justify local means, when we did it, we justified it by some fact of nature, namely the self-similarity of images. Here, it's a theorem. We know that this is the best we can do. Okay? So we do have the formula, and what is more, one can somehow start envisaging to compute it. So it's not yet done, but we have seen recently some attempts using, for instance, neural networks, etc. So I won't insist on that. And I will end this expression by some examples. Okay? So just to show some also that on image quality, this means something. So this is a small piece of an image that I showed before. This is a very noisy version of it. This is what you get with DCT denoising, which is not bad, but which is slightly blurred. And also, well, I don't see it on the screen, so you don't see it, but there is actually some ringing here. You can see it here, like horizontal vertical structure that is produced. This is what is being done by a wavelet-based algorithm that is actually very efficient in terms of error, but not visually very convincing. This is NLMINS, which is good but slightly blurry. This is KSVD, which is using sparse basis. And these two are algorithms that are actually being used in hundreds of millions of cameras, as far as I know. This is BM3D, which is used, for instance, in many most Nokia camera phones. It still has some ringing. One can, if you look carefully, you can see some defects here. And this is non-local bias that I personally prefer. It is used, for instance, was selected by Dxo, also for hundreds of millions of cameras. And well, so this is the state of the art so far, and it's really better than what we had before because images look good and they don't have any more artifacts. This doesn't mean that the story is finished, but only that it's that having good formulas helps. So thank you, and we're ready for your questions.
We are out of time. Any questions, comments?
Okay. Yes. Just I want to know, you have discussed the performance of wavelet methods and other methods which you have mentioned here, where the people are replacing wavelet by curvelets, shearlets, or alpha molecule in the recent years, like Uttani Yoka for Technical University of Berlin, or Candice for the invited speaker.
Yes,
so
yes.
What is your comment?
Well, yes, in fact, so to say, it's it's old-fashioned to fix the wavelet basis. In fact, the last method I showed, for example, VN3, in fact, and the last one, and a non-local bias, actually compute for each set of patches the adapted basis, but trivially as a PCA. You know, so in fact, the technology shows that you do always better by adapting as carefully as possible to your data. So in fact, so to say, I would say for me, historically, it's searching for a fixed basis that will be better than the former one belongs to the past. It has been our first love and our first excitement. And now, somehow, it's more trivial what is being done, but it's also more adapted. But of course, when you look at the PCA of a set of patches and look at you see a basis, and this is the wavelet basis adapted to this one. This is what is happening.
Okay, other question?
Actually, I have two questions. One question is related to the computational cost. Maybe since you use the local structures, maybe speed is a little bit slow than conventional total relation based. Yeah. The other question is related to other kind of nodes. For instance, there is a multiplicative node in coherent system. Multiplicative node is in coherent radar system. In that case, maybe it's already difficult to apply your techniques.
Yeah. Okay, so for your first question, so the computational cost is growing very fast. And so to my big surprise, companies, I wouldn't say that they don't care, but they see a prospect of a very fast growing computational power in any camera, in any camera phone. So basically, they leave the door wide open to having algorithms that go up to 1 million operations per pixel, which is completely huge. So, but we don't see limits to that. So. Anyway, it's true, for instance, that this complexity goes very fast up, and so this is why I showed distant denoising, that is a completely valuable algorithm that is extremely low computationally and is still used in some camera phones and so on. But nevertheless, indeed, one of the trends now is to see how we can reduce the complexity for the method like non-local means. In fact, non-local means is not fast, but it's relatively fast, because you do it locally, contrary to its name, okay? If you want to make it fast, you make it local, that's all. But it decreases slightly the performance, but not more. The last method I showed, so the global denoise-based denoising, well, it's something that clearly will be done, because the trend now is that most algorithms won't be executed in a compute, in a personal computer or in a phone. They'll be executed in a cloud, in cloud computing. And this is the other reason why now the field is quite open to us mathematicians to think of as clever algorithms as we wish, as powerful as we wish, because in fact there is no limitation to the computational power from the point where you send the data and it's processed by some intermediate dealer. As for total variation has never been a really good denoiser. It's a very good method to deblur. So in deblurring, there is nothing that replaces total variation. When it comes to denoise, it's fast, but it's not the state of the art. It's at the level of DCD denoising, or even slightly inferior. Now, for your second question, which is radar and multiplicative noise, well, that's absolutely true. In multiplicative noise, it's very structured, and for structured noise, all that I said simply doesn't apply as such. It has to be investigated.
Okay, any other
question? One question, can you comment on the efficient implementation of using non-local patches? Because there are many more patches when you go non-local than the local, bilateral kernels. So how do you do it efficiently?
Ah, you mean the completely non-local? So, yeah, okay. So this is one of the trends of the current technology is to be able to organize a metric space. The set of all patches is a set of vectors in 64 dimensions, for instance. And of course, if you want to describe this metric space, you have to compute all distance of all patches to all order. It's impossible. Still, for the technology, not really, it's impossible. But there are better and better organizations for a big data set, typically as a tree. As you know, so if you are able to organize in a dictionary big data, retrieval is very fast, and that means that you can at least answer the question, what are the all distances, but what are the closest distances? So what are the n closest patches to a patch? This can be done in a reasonable time. That means that once you have organized your databases. And this, for instance, you can see even on the web, because, for instance, you have, not for patches exactly, but for recognizing images, you have on the web facilities that are able to retrieve a photograph given searching in billions of images, and that they are using these fast retrieval techniques. They work. Sure.
More questions or comments? Okay, Professor.
So, do you agree non-local means are related to dictionary-based instead of patches, and you essentially expand the course instead of patches?
Dictionary-based, yeah. Yeah, but, well, yes. So in the Nadler-Levin presentation, your dictionary is extensive. It's all the possible patches, okay? So there is no selection. Because there are two senses, I don't know if I understand your question, because there are two different meanings to the dictionary. It can be like in KSVD, you know, you select, you learn some sparse dictionaries. Yeah, okay. So, well, yes, in fact, basically, when you use a patch and you find the closest ones, if you do PCA of that, it's very sparse. I mean, only a few coefficients are enough. In that sense, a thresholding works. So that the BN3D method that I showed does a thresholding. So implicitly, indeed, denoising works as much better, of course, if you found the right basis for each patch. Yes.
So
yeah. Yeah.
Instead of minimizing TV or L1, you minimize the different basis, which is adapted to the
input. Yeah, okay, yes. Yeah, that's a valuable interpretation, yes.
Okay, any more questions, comments? Okay, thanks to speak again.